An emergency or disaster can strike at any time without warning. OSHA defines a workplace emergency as a situation which threatens workers, customers, or the public, disrupts or shuts down operations, or causes physical or environmental damage. Employers and employees should be prepared to deal with such situations and plan how to respond. The best way is to prepare a response before an emergency occurs. Many situations which occur during emergencies can be anticipated in the planning process. This allows employers and employees to plan a course of action to take if needed. It can be difficult to think clearly and logically during a crisis, so it is important to do so in advance. Preparing before an emergency event occurs plays a vital role in ensuring employers and employees have the right equipment, know where to go when it happens, and how to keep safe. Companies need to establish an Emergency Action Plan, or EAP. The EAP will be the guide for employers and employees to help prepare and respond accordingly when an emergency incident happens. This training program will look at the key points of emergency planning, including Emergency Action Plan, Development and Implementation, Training and Plan Review, Evacuation Elements, Fight or Flee, Fire, Rescue and Medical Services, Reporting Emergencies, and Medical Surveillance. Emergency Action Plan. An emergency action plan is developed to facilitate and organize employer and employee actions during a workplace emergency. Almost every business is required to have an emergency action plan. If fire extinguishers are required or provided in your workplace, and if anyone will be evacuating during a fire or other emergency, then OSHA 29 CFR 1910.157 requires you to have an EAP. A well-thought-out plan and proper training will generally result in organized responses in emergency situations, safe and quick evacuations, fewer and less severe injuries, and less damage to the work facility. A comprehensive EAP will describe how employees are to respond to different types of emergencies and consider specific worksite layouts, structural features, and emergency systems. OSHA provides a checklist to consider when writing the plan. It is beneficial to include a diverse group of employees and company management in the EAP planning process and to meet frequently to review progress and allocate development tasks. An EAP will only be successful if its content is up to date and employees are sufficiently educated and trained before an actual evacuation. At a minimum, the plan must include the following elements: the means for reporting fires and other emergencies, evacuation procedures and emergency escape route assignments, procedures for employees who remain to operate critical plant operations before they evacuate, and accounting for all employees after an emergency evacuation has been completed, rescue and medical duties for employees performing them, names or job titles of persons who can be contacted for additional information. It may also be helpful to include the following in an EAP plan: a description of the alarm system to be used to notify employees to evacuate and/or take action. The alarms used for different emergencies should be distinctive. The site of an alternate communication center to be used in the event of a fire or explosion. A secure off-site location to store originals or duplicate copies of accounting records, legal documents, employee emergency contact list, and other essential records. Several OSHA standards address emergency planning requirements. Additionally, the National Fire Protection Association and the American National Standards Institute have recommendations and requirements about emergency planning. Employers should be familiar with these and other standard-setting organizations. Development and implementation. Creating a written emergency action plan is not enough to ensure the safety of employees. When an evacuation is necessary, a safe and successful evacuation requires responsible, trained individuals who can supervise and coordinate all actions and activities. The EAP must be up to date, and employees must be properly educated and trained before an actual evacuation. The plan should be site-specific in regard to emergency conditions evaluated, evacuation policies and procedures, emergency reporting mechanisms, and alarm systems. EAPs should include employees in the planning process, specify what employees should do during an emergency, and ensure employees receive proper training for emergencies. It is common to assign an individual to lead and coordinate the EAP and evacuation. Employees must know who the coordinator is and understand this person has the authority to make decisions during emergencies. It is essential to review the plan with employees and make sure everyone knows what to do before, during, and after an emergency. It is recommended to keep a copy of the EAP in a location that is easily accessible to all employees. When emergency officials, such as the local fire department, respond to an emergency at your workplace, they will assume responsibility for the safety of all occupants. They will have the authority to make decisions regarding evacuation and other necessary actions to protect life and property. The highest-ranking responder will assume the command role and be responsible for directing all response activities. Training and plan review. All employees must understand the function and elements of the EAP. This must include types of potential emergencies, reporting procedures, alarm systems, evacuation plans, and shutdown procedures. Employees must be clear on who is in charge during an emergency. Each shift must have a designated individual. Specific special hazards such as flammable materials, toxic chemicals, radioactive sources, or water reactive substances must be covered. Employees must be informed of the fire hazards to which they are exposed to and those parts of the fire prevention plan necessary for self-protection. Before implementing the emergency action plan, employers must designate and train enough people to assist in the safe and orderly emergency evacuation of employees. Employers should review the plan with each employee when the initial plan is developed and when each employee is initially assigned to the job. Employers should review the plan with each employee when his or her actions or responsibilities under the plan change, or when the EAP plan changes. Effective plans often call for retraining employees annually and include drills in which employees can practice evacuating their workplace and gathering in the assembly area. General training should address the following: individual roles and responsibilities, threats, hazards, and protective actions, notification, warning, and communications procedures, means for contacting family members in an emergency, emergency response procedures, evacuation, shelter, and accountability procedures, location and use of common emergency equipment, and emergency shutdown procedures. Once training has been provided, it is a good idea to hold practice drills as often as necessary to keep everyone prepared. Include outside resources such as fire and police departments whenever possible. After each drill, evaluate the effectiveness of the drill, identify strengths and weakness, and make improvements. Outdated plans can lead to injuries and even death. EAPs should be reviewed regularly and updated whenever an employee's emergency actions or responsibilities change. This includes a change in the layout or design of the facility, new equipment, hazardous material, or when processes are introduced that affect the evacuation routes. Always be aware of new types of hazards that require special actions. Facility and agency contact information is usually the most common outdated item in EAPs. Consider placing this important information on a separate page in the front of the EAP so it can be easily updated. Evacuation elements. A disorganized evacuation can result in confusion, injury, property damage, and even death. There are many things to think about when considering evacuation, such as the conditions under which an evacuation would be necessary. Several emergencies, both man-made and natural, may require evacuation and include hurricanes, tornadoes, earthquakes, floods, wildfires, winter weather, chemical spills or releases, disease outbreaks, releases of biological agents, explosions, and many other hazards. Different emergencies require different responses. The EAP must identify when and how employees respond to different types of emergencies. There might be times when it would be better to shelter in place rather than evacuate. Shelter in place means to select a small interior room or rooms with no or few windows within your place of employment and take refuge there rather than evacuate the area or seek a community emergency shelter. It might be safer to remain indoors rather than evacuate if there's an accidental or intentional release of chemical, biological, or radiological contaminants into the environment in large quantity and or close proximity to your workplace. When considering evacuation, you must also think about the chain of command and designation of the person authorized to order an evacuation or shutdown. Will employees be required to remain in order to shut down critical operations before evacuating? This is a question to consider in the planning stages. The evacuation route and exits must be determined. Exit route should be clearly marked and well lit, as well as unobstructed and clear of clutter and debris. Routes should be marked with signs reading exit. Doorways or passages along the exit route, which could be mistaken for an exit, such as a closet, must be marked not an exit or similar designation, or be identified by a sign indicating its actual use. Evacuation routes and exits should be mapped out and posted for all employees to see. The final thing to cover when considering evacuation is the method of accounting for all employees and possible visitors. Designate assembly areas where employees should gather after evacuating. Someone should be given the duty to count the employees in each evacuation location. They should be able to provide names and last known location of anyone missing to the official in charge. Fight or flee. A fire is the most common type of emergency for which businesses must plan. A critical decision when planning is whether employees should fight a small fire with a portable fire extinguisher or simply evacuate. Small fires can often be put out quickly by a well-trained employee with a portable fire extinguisher. However, to do this safely, the employee must understand the use and limitation of a portable fire extinguisher and the hazards associated with fighting fires. Choosing to evacuate the workplace rather than providing fire extinguishers for employee use in fighting fires will most effectively minimize the potential for fire-related injuries to employees. Attempting to extinguish even a small fire carries some risk. Fires can increase in size and intensity in seconds, blocking the exit path of a firefighter and creating a hazardous atmosphere. In addition, portable fire extinguishers contain a limited amount of extinguishing agent and can be discharged in a matter of seconds. Fire, rescue, and medical services. unless you are a large employer handling hazardous materials and processes, or have employees regularly working in hazardous situations, you will probably choose to rely on local public resources to provide these specialized services. If you choose to use external departments or agencies, such as the local fire and police departments, medical clinics or hospitals, and ambulance services, make sure they are prepared to respond as outlined in your plan. Have the local fire department conduct a walkthrough of your workplace so they are familiar with the layout and any potential hazards. Establish a relationship with the local ambulance service so transportation is readily available for emergencies. Plan with nearby medical clinics or other facilities to handle emergency cases and to provide medical and first aid services to employees. If an infirmary, clinic, or hospital is not close to your workplace, ensure that on-site persons have adequate first aid training. Reporting emergencies. Employees must know how to report emergencies. The use of internal telephones, intercom, or public address systems are suitable options to use to notify other employees. No matter what system is used, it is imperative that emergency situations be immediately reported. Fires and other emergency situations can reach dangerous levels in seconds, and any delay in getting emergency responders to the scene can result in additional loss of life and property. Employees must also notify the proper authorities, such as fire, medical, or rescue services, if necessary. Calling 911 is a common means for reporting emergencies to outside emergency personnel. Medical surveillance. After an incident, it is important to analyze health information and look for problems that may be occurring in the workplace that require targeted prevention. Thus, medical surveillance serves as a feedback loop to the employer. Surveillance may be based on a single case or event, but more typically uses screening results from the group of employees being evaluated to look for abnormal trends in health status. Surveillance can also be conducted on a single employee over time. Review of group results helps to identify potential problem areas and the effectiveness of existing worksite preventative strategies. The incident and materials involved will determine the type of surveillance required as per OSHA. Conclusion: emergency action plans are an important part of every workplace. Following the plan during an emergency could be the difference between life and death. Make sure your company's plan is up to date and you understand all aspects of it. Hopefully, you will never be in an emergency situation, but if you are, knowing the EAP could save your life.